here today, my leader, Dean Skelos, and we're here today to help to put people back to work and to open up opportunity for small business here in the state of New York. And we want to make sure that the Latino community is not part of that, but front and center. And that's why we're here today organizing these efforts along with the Unidad Latino Conference to make sure that everybody is not only at the table, but is participating. The Latino small businesses are key drivers to the economic growth and jobs both nationally and in New York State. There are presently 1.6 million Hispanic-owned businesses in the nation, boasting more than $220 billion in annual gross receipts. New York City alone, there are close to 100,000 Hispanic-owned small businesses, and this panel will discuss some of the unique challenges that Latino entrepreneurs face in the world of business and highlight what must be done to better support these businesses through loans, microenterprises, small business development, credits, and other measures that will give us opportunities to open up these small businesses and keep these small businesses flourishing here in the state of New York. We have three great panelists here today, and I'm impressed with this lineup. And Luis Balzac, from the former director of Puerto Rico Industrial Development Company. And we have Hector Cordero Guzmán, professor of School of Public Affairs at Baruch College. And Des Vélez, the Executive Director of Minority and Women Business Development, Empire State Development Corporation. All three of these gentlemen will participate and give us a picture of what's going on out there and how we can assist in putting people back to work. What's keeping small businesses from performing and getting out in front? Where is it? Is it a business plan? Is it the access to capital? Is it workforce, education? Is it the regulations that we have here in the city and the state of New York? Or is it just plain fear? I'm a small business owner myself. I was a New York City police officer in my first life. My second life, I was injured in the New York City Police Department, retired from there in 1983, and then went into opening up a catering hall in Bay Ridge, the Bay Ridge Manor, and the Fifth Avenue Board of Trade, and started a conglomerate of different avenues and brought those avenues together and put them under the Bay Ridge Bensonhurst Alliance so that we could have access to funding, reduce regulation, and give opportunity for small business to be successful here in the city of New York. And we not only encouraged a tremendous number of different groups to participate in small business owners, but we fought the city and the state at many levels, and we were successful. And that's the bottom line, is being successful so that you, as an entrepreneur, have the ability to put people to work, have access to capital, have a workforce to work with, and have the ability to have your product out in the market and being successful long-term. Short-term, long-term goals. With the assistance of the state, we want to be there with you to make sure that we give you those opportunities. We're going to start with a good individual that I just spoke with, Luis Balzac, and he's the former director of the Puerto Rican Industrial Development Company, a government-owned corporation dedicated to promoting Puerto Rico as an investment destination for companies and industries worldwide. I was telling Luis how many times I've been to Puerto Rico. I love it. My wife loves it. It's changed over the number of years that I've been going there, and I've been going there since about 1968. He's helped to create best sponsorship practices for maximizing the agency's contributions and collaborations and directed the administration's economic development initiatives. He's also founder and president of Balzac Capo Communications, a trusted marketing and business development firm that over 10 years of experience in both the private and government sector. Oh, wow. Mr. Balzac currently serves as the Government Relations and Public Affairs Director of Pfizer and has previously served as the Northeast Regional Director of Puerto Rican Federal Affairs Administration, where he's developed cooperation strategies for the economic, social, and political empowerment of Hispanics in the U.S. and Puerto Rico on the island. Mr. Balcas has a bachelor's degree in business administration from Loyola College, University, and New Orleans, L.A., with a major in marketing. Ladies and gentlemen, please help us to introduce Luis, and I'm going to just name the other two gentlemen that will be here. Will be Dr. Hector Arcadero Guzman, and I will do his resume when we bring him up, and Das Velez, and I will bring his resume when he stands. Ladies and gentlemen, Luis Balzac.
Thank you, Senator Golden. Is this good audio? Is it too loud? Perfect. So I'm going to try to be informal. I think most of us attend many presentations like this one, and I want to do my best to not bore anybody and keep everyone engaged. I'll tell you a little bit about what I was doing and how I ended up at this panel and how things change. Like Senator introduced, my name is Luis Balzac. I represented the office of Governor Luis Fortuño here in New York. And in doing so, I had different responsibilities, including promoting Puerto Rico as a destination for investment, manufacturing, and so on. And also did many projects as it relates to federal affairs, lobbying, and that type of initiative. And going back to early 2011, I had the opportunity to have lunch with a Mojica and Wilkis Lopez, who works with Senator Dean Skelos, and we were doing our best to have a collaboration and include the government of Puerto Rico to have this event, which I thought was very important and very it could be very productive. Unfortunately, the governor of Puerto Rico is the chair of an organization called CSG, the Council of State Governments, and they are right now in Washington, Seattle, Washington, in their annual a convention, so he was unable to join us. So although I work now with Pfizer as their government relations director, covering Puerto Rico, some DC issues, federal, and here in New York City, I'm gonna wear my former director of Puerto Rico Industrial Development and talk on small business. I think that as we find ways to help provide tools to the owners of small business, it's important that we do not reinvent the wheel. There are certain tools that are already in place that we need to repeat constantly to make sure that individuals make use of those existing tools. And even though I'm here today, what I will do is I will use the words and a PowerPoint presentation that I'm gonna be reading a few bullets from a friend called Jorge Silva Puras. And I'm gonna stress something, and for us to understand that some of these things are bipartisan. This is a perfect example of Republicans and Democrats working together. I worked for Governor Fortuño. Jorge Silva Puras was the chief of staff of the governor that was before Governor Fortuño. Typically, people like that don't collaborate. Jorge and I collaborate, we talk. And I was with him on the phone yesterday, and I thought that the best thing for me to do in order to be of service to you folks was to use his presentation, because there are certain tools at the Small Business Administration office that are available for everyone. And instead of me coming up here reinventing the wheel and looking smart, I thought that the best thing for me to do would be to share those tools that Jorge wants to make sure that everyone understands. And also in doing so, I also want to remind everyone, again, along the lines of not reinventing the wheel, that in New York, we have chambers of commerce and organizations that can play an instrumental role in the success of small business. We have the New York City Hispanic Chamber of Commerce here today. I saw that Alfred Placeres from the New York State Federation of Hispanic Chambers of Commerce. Like them, there are others. These people care about the success of the small business, and we all know already that Latinos are a huge percentage of that growing population. And among them, I'm proud to say that women are among even the highest percentage. So it's great. Now, before I go into the bullets, I would just like to understand how many of us here, because I claim myself one because I had my own consulting firm, how many of us here are owners of small business by show of hands? Okay. And so some of the things that I'm going to say, I'm hoping that you guys already are aware of. I've been in many presentations. Recently, I was with Congressman Nidia Velasquez, and she was doing her best to make sure that people understand that the federal government has procurement programs and has dollars that are being spent, and is a mandate that Hispanic businesses are part of that percentage of where the money is allocated. But we all need to be very clear, and we need to understand that for you to be able to do business with the federal government, you have to be registered as an 8-8. And a lot of paperwork goes through that, and it can be overwhelming. But I can tell you that there are organizations like the Chambers of Commerce and individuals that can help you go through that process so that you can be certified and enjoy the benefits of doing business with the government. Millions of dollars are being spent. Firms are being hired. They're growing from you know, 2 to 3 employees to over 100 employees, and it happens once you complete the process and you start doing business with the government. I am not suggesting that your only client should be the government, because it should also be combined with the private sector. But I am saying that the government now could be a good client and it should not be excluded, okay? So I'm going to go through the presentation and make sure that people understand when the SBA director for Region 2, and I just want to repeat for those of you that didn't catch that, Region 2 covers New York, New Jersey, Puerto Rico, and the Virgin Islands. That's the jurisdiction. And they have an initiative, and they call it the 3 C's. The capital for access, contracting with the federal government, which is what I just mentioned, and counseling and training. And I think that the last one is particularly important. And by the way, I'm going to do something now so that I don't forget. I'm going to give everyone my email, so that if anybody wants me to email this PowerPoint with all the details, if I missed something, I will do so. And I'm going to use my personal email, okay? So here we go. It's Luis, and that's L-U-I-S, at Balzac. That's my last name. It's B-A-L-Z-A-C, Capo, which is another last name, C-A-P-O.com. Luis at BalzacCapo.com. If I get an email from anybody today, just remind me that you were here, and I will email the presentation immediately, okay? So there are a few programs as it relates to loans. And what's important to understand is that the maximum loan amount has increased from $2 million to $5 million. And of those loans, 85% is guaranteed on loans up to $150,000. That's important because what it means is that now, you know, loans have gone bigger because we understand that the needs of small businesses can be pretty challenging and that people do need the capital. So instead of two, you know, you can get up to $5 million. A 504 certified development company, a maximum loan amount, like I said, can go to up to two to $5 million. And the maximum guarantee could be 100% on SBA's portion. They also have microloans, and the microloans are those much smaller. The amount was also increased from $35,000 to $50,000. And that can be used to purchase machinery, equipment, work capital, leasehold improvements, and increase receivables. For those of us that have had a small business, and I had one, that includes buying printers, stationery, and all types of expenses that could make the difference in you landing a good account with a client. There are also some advantage loan initiatives, and those are streamlined through an application 7A. And this is where we go back to, you have to make sure that you do the paperwork and you get certified so you can apply for these loans, okay? By way of example, as it relates to New York, and these are recent numbers, as recent as January of this year. 504 loans increased 38%. It went from $48 million in the year 2010 to $59 million in 2011. 7A loans increased 199%. That's a significant increase. So some people are taking advantage. What I don't have here is the breakdown of the numbers to understand how are we doing as a community? Are we taking advantage of these loans? And are we going to be able to use them to move our needle as far as increasing our business? the other C. So that was the first C that I just described was the capital access, and now the contracting with the federal government. In 2009, the federal government purchased almost a $500 billion in products and services. And that is where you can be applying through 8-8 certification and make sure that you have those documents so you can apply and enjoy the benefits of being in the procurement program with the federal government. 8A, and by 8A, I mean number 8, parentheses, letter A, small a. That's the qualification that I'm referring to. And that provides a broad scope of training and assistance to socially and economically disadvantaged firms. You must be in business for at least 2 years with a product or service that the federal government purchases, procures. They also have some hub zones. Hub, as in H-U-B, stands for historically underutilized business zones. So if you are going to decide on opening up a business and you will have brick and mortar, if you're going to have an actual office, a location, storage, distribution, you may want to do your research and find out if you can be in one of those zones, because being in one of those zones will qualify you for significant benefits that will have an impact in your bottom line. All this information, and for those that want it, I'll email it, but I'll say it aloud just in case. You can find at sba.gov/hub zone. The Women-Owned Small Business Federal Contracting Program. You will also find that this is a program that allows contracting officers for the first time to set aside specific contracting opportunities for certified women-owned small businesses. And the goal is to have 5% federal contracting dollars awarded to this type of business. The last item that I want to mention to everyone is the counseling and training. I was not aware until today and yesterday when I spoke to Jorge Silva Puras that SBA has an office in Albany where if you have a business, for no charge, you can actually have SBA help you prepare a white paper. For those of you that are in conversations with a bank, a financial institution, I'm sure you understand how hard it is to come to capital. And when you have a white paper prepared by the federal government with some research on the type of business that you are pitching to this financial institution, that could be the difference in you receiving those dollars that you need to grow your business. Use those tools that we have. If it's overwhelming, become part of a chamber. Find individuals that have been through this before so that you can take advantage of it. We need to come together and do this. We cannot complain that there are no dollars out there and that we don't have any clients and that we want a bigger piece of the pie if we are not completing all the processes that we have to do and going through all the, you know, crossing our T's, dotting our I's, so that we can compete with those individuals that are getting the money from both large companies and the federal government. And I will remind one thing to everyone. Large corporations have procurement programs. I work for Pfizer. They have procurement programs. They also have similar initiatives to the ones that the federal government has. They want to do business with Latinos. And they also require those institutions, those businesses, to be a certified. When you are an 8A certified business with the federal government, you can use that to be able to qualify in the private sector. I remember going back to 1999, I think, Verizon gave a $10 million grant to the United States Hispanic Chamber of Commerce. I think at that point, the president of the chamber was George Herrera from the Bronx. And the chair of the USACC, also from the Bronx, was Elizabeth Lisboa Faro. $10 million were given to the Chamber of Commerce, and they went ahead and designed and built a procurement program to help small businesses in the private sector, because Verizon, the Verizons of the world, Pfizer, Time Warner, they want to do business with the Latino community. We are the ones that are growing. Their clients are diversified. They have Latino clients. So they want to be able to claim some credit for doing business with us. It makes them look good, and we provide good services. With that, I'll close. If you have any questions, I'll be able to share. And I hope that I get a lot of emails from you so that I can share the presentation and connect you with the office of Jorge Silva Puras and myself to help you with anything you need.
Thank you, Luis. As I said before, was it a building plan? Is it a access to capital? Is it workforce? Is it a process of expansion? Is it education, regulation? And the key word here is, and takes away that fear, and that's the knowledge. And I believe Luis has pointed out knowledge that could give us the ability to move forward, knowing that there is access, there is opportunity, and help to be able to assist us in getting the dollars into our business and getting those businesses successful and keeping them successful. Our next individual here is a doctor. We will have questions at the end of this after all three speakers have spoken. We will open up the forum. And the next gentleman is Dr. Hectór R. Cordero Guzmán. Dr. Hectór Cordero Guzmán is a professor at the School of Public Affairs at Baruch College and the City University of New York, as well as a PhD programs in sociology and in urban education at the CUNY Graduate School and University Center. Prior to joining CUNY, Dr. Cordero Guzmán was a program officer of the Economic Development Unit at the Ford Foundation. Dr. Cordero Guzmán developed and managed the foundation's grant portfolio on human resource and workforce development that supports organizations, program strategies and initiatives that improve the public policies and infrastructure for the delivery of human capital, building and workforce development services and programs to low-income people. Dr. Cordero Guzmán has published academic research on issues related to education, employment, poverty, race, and inequality, nonprofit organizations, economic development, and social welfare policies. He's also served on the board of directors of a number of nonprofit organizations, including ACCION New York, the Community Service Society of New York, and the Upper Manhattan Empowerment Zone. Dr. Cordero Guzmán received his MA and PhD degrees in the sociology and demographics of University of Chicago. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Hectór R. Cordero Guzmán.
Thank you.
Senator can read all of that, and it's always very embarrassing. But having been a New York City cop, I'll take my hat off to you. That's the job that we all really rely on, and I thank you for your service,
thank you,
Senator. Thank you very much. Thanks for the opportunity to the Federation and to all of you. I'm a data person, so what I'm going to come to do here, if I can get the computer going, is to give you a presentation on the characteristics of small businesses. We can talk about policy issues, but we also need to know how many small businesses are we talking about, who they are, what they do, and how they do it. So my goal in 10 minutes is to give you some information on the composition of Latino businesses in the state of New York. And like Luis, I'm happy to send the presentation to anyone. This is work in progress. I'm trying to update the data. The data comes on years that end up in 2 or in 7. So I have 1997, 2002, and I'm still working on 2007, and we're going to get another round of data in 2012. All of you that get, and I saw there were a lot of small business owners here, all of you that get a survey or a questionnaire about your small businesses, please fill it out and send it, because that's the only way we can really find out and do studies about the characteristics of these businesses. All of the information that I have about how many businesses, where they are, what they do, comes from the businesses themselves that are supplying us this information. So if we don't get the information, I'm sorry, I'm standing in the wrong spot.
Yeah, I just can't.
Okay, I'll just stand here.
Stand there.
I'll stay here. So if I don't get the information, it's really hard to know and to count. So in 1997, there were about 104,000 Latino firms. By 2002, the number had grown to about 163,000. And by 2007, the number had grown to 200,000. So between 1997 and 2007, we saw an increase in about 100,000 Latino firms in the state of New York, and a doubling of the Latino firms in the state of New York. I consider that a fairly impressive growth. So the community hasn't grown just demographically in people. It's also grown in institutions and organizations and businesses. And this data clearly documented. In the USA, overall, there were about 1.2 million Latino firms in 97 and about 1.6 million firms in 2002. So there was a 57% increase in the number of Latino firms within these 2 points compared to a 31% increase in the national level. So Latino firms at the national level are also exploding at a 31% rate, but the Latino firms in the state of New York are growing even faster. They're outpacing the growth of Latino firms, even in states like California, which I'll show you in a couple of slides more. In 1997, the sales and receipts of Latino firms totaled about $10.3 billion. And we're talking about, you know, $10.3 billion in those 1997 dollars that weren't worth as much as the, you know, billions of today. So factor that in when you think about this few billions, because we're used to hearing such big amounts that we may think this is actually not that much. It is a lot of money. In 2002, it went up to $12.4 billion, and by 2007, Latino firms were selling or grossing about $8.3 billion. A decent amount, you know, and the growth in the decade, you can track about $8 billion in growth over the 10 years. There was an increase in sales and receipts of about $2.1 billion between 97 and 2002, and $4.1 billion between 2002 and 2007. And the reason I bring that up is to show you that the growth rate is actually increasing. They're growing at a faster pace in the last five-year period than in the preceding five-year period. If you're interested in sales of Latino firms at the national level, they were about $186 billion in 97 and about $221 billion in 2002. Sales and receipts increased about 20% in New York and about 19% at the national level. This is the number of firms, and I just have 97 and 2002 until I get to update the numbers. But I was just showing you that the rate of growth in New York was larger or faster than the rate of growth in California, which grew by 27%. Texas, which has the second highest number of Latino firms, grew by 33%. Florida has the third largest number, grew by 38%. New York has the fourth largest number of Latino firms and grew by 57%. And New Jersey had the fifth largest number of Latino firms, went from 36,000 to 49,000. I may be missing Illinois here. I'll double check that. I may have just put New Jersey ahead of the queue because I knew it was in the East Coast and we wanted to maybe learn more about New Jersey than about Illinois. Of the 193,000 firms in the state, and I apologize to the other Hispanic brothers and sisters in the room, the data is only collected for, I mean, when you check Hispanic, they only give you a choice to say more if you're Mexican, Puerto Rican, or Cuban. So everybody else is aggregated into this other Hispanic category. That category is dominated by Dominicans, Colombians, and Ecuadorians in that order, mostly Dominicans. So I separated the Puerto Rican firms just to give you, I mean, there were about 34,000 Puerto Rican firms, about 21,000 Mexican firms, about 7,000 Cuban firms, and if you add those all up, it was about 60,000. So there were about 120,000 firms that were owned by other Hispanics. So the other Hispanics actually have a higher entrepreneurship rate, if you will, than these groups that are highlighted here. If you just want to separate or isolate Puerto Rican firms, they had about $3.1 billion in receipts. Only 2,000 of the 34,000 firms actually had employees. So many of these appear to be consulting companies or holding companies or some other such form. And they employed about 15,000 people directly, and the payroll was about $481 million of these 2,900 Puerto Rican firms. That's not the payroll for all the Puerto Rican firms. That's just for those 2,000 that had direct other employees. And remember, many firms today work through subcontractors and other things. I'm not going to get into that. We can. Let me jump into, I have a few characteristics of the firms, but I know our time is short. So I'll just give you some of the highlights. The number of firms and employees was highest in services. About 58% of Latino firms were in the service sector, and then in construction. But the highest returns, the most money, was made in the wholesale and retail and in industry. Okay? So this is where most of the employees were, and this is where most of the money was made. And again, all the charts and graphs are backup to these kind of conclusions. And again, I'm more than happy. I'm actually trying to write this up into an article, so hopefully you'll get the article and the tables will be included. So the first thing I try to do is to try to get a sense of who are the Latino businesses. And those are the characteristics. The next thing is, who are the Latino business owners? They're slightly different questions. One is about the institutions, and the other is about the individual that may be the principal owners of the institutions. So this next little piece I'll talk to you about is a little bit more about the characteristics of Latino business owners. In New York City, and this is that, you know, I need to update the data, but still good. 24.5% of the adult population was Hispanic. 53.4% worked for private enterprise. 13.7% worked for government. But then about 9.1% of Latinos were self-employed or business owners, if you will. 1.5%, I call them kind of part-time self-employed. 3.1% are owners of businesses, but they're also paying themselves a salary out of their own business. And 4.4% are what we might want to call the kind of full-time self-employed. So they're not in a firm necessarily that may employ other people directly. But it's total about 9.1%. And for Hispanics overall, it's about 6.6% in terms of the self-employment rate. And I'll jump into some conclusions. For whites in the city, about 13% are self-employed or are what we call entrepreneurs. For Asians, it's about 10%. For other Hispanics, it's about 9%. And for Hispanics overall, it's about 6.6%. The rates vary. The highest rates of Hispanic business ownership, Colombia, Peru, other South America, about 10%. Cuban, Dominican, Mexican, between 7% and 10%. And then Puerto Rican and Central America, less than 6%. In terms of, again, the business owners. Queens has the highest proportion of entrepreneurs, followed by Manhattan. The highest age group is between 36 and 40 years of age. That's the typical age of a Latino business owner. Entrepreneurs are more likely to be foreign-born than when you look at Latino entrepreneurs, they have a higher proportion that are born not in the U.S. than the non-entrepreneurs. Entrepreneurs tend to work more hours per week and more weeks per year, and all of us that are in that are not necessarily surprised by the finding, but sometimes it's good to document it. And again, I don't want to really go through the tables. I'll just jump to some of the conclusions. Education matters for entrepreneurship. 45% of entrepreneurs have a college degree or more, but 15% of Latino entrepreneurs have a college degree or more. So whereas 45% of entrepreneurs in New York City have a college degree, 15% of Latino entrepreneurs have a college degree. Another 20% have some college and an associate degree compared to 21% among Latinos. 17% of entrepreneurs have a high school degree, but 24% of Latino entrepreneurs have a high school degree. Only 18% of entrepreneurs in New York do not have a high school degree, but 40% of Latino self-employed do not have a high school degree. I'm suggesting that education matters for entrepreneurship, but it's not necessarily an obstacle for in some industries to be able to be an entrepreneur without having to have an MBA from Harvard. Though, of course, there are going to be different kinds of businesses that you'll be running. That's a separate part of the lecture, I would suppose. But there are a lot of, again, 40% of Latino small businesses in New York City self-employed are do not have a high school degree. Self-employed rates increase with levels of education among all New Yorkers and Latinos. So close to 6% of Latinos with a high school degree were self-employed, compared to 8% of Latinos with a bachelor's degree, compared to 10% of those with a master's degree, compared to 13% of those with a doctor. And those charts are designed to kind of show you what those trends look like. And lastly, the self-employed make more money than similar workers that are in the salaried market. So those that work for themselves are working more hours and working more weeks, but it seems to be paying off in the sense that they're making a little bit more than those that have the same level of skill but are working for salary a labor market. The average Hispanic made $19,000. The average self-employed Hispanic made $25,000. For men, it was 23 versus 29%, 23 for the average male and 29 for the self-employed male. For women, it was 15 versus 23. So there's still a gender gap between both, but it looks like self-employment pays, at least for this population. Again, in 1997, there were 104,000 firms, 163 in 2002, one almost 200,000 by 2007. 57% increase in the number of Latino firms in New York compared to 31% increase at the national level. Self-employment rates vary by ethnicity. But in Latinos, between the 6% and 10%. Self-employment rates increase with levels of education. Latino entrepreneurs are more likely to be foreign-born. Latino entrepreneurs work more hours per week and more weeks per year than the non-entrepreneurs. but they make more money. The average Hispanic Latino earned $19,000, but the average self-employed Hispanic or Latino earned $25,000. Now, the last piece is to talk about a way, so what can we do to grow Latino businesses? And Luis talked about the three C's. And my old mentor, Professor Tim Bates, used to talk about the three M's. And given that I have an audience that's a lot more knowledgeable about public policy issues and educated than I could ever be, I do know maybe a little bit about entrepreneurship and small business from the research perspective, although I'm a practitioner myself, but that's a separate discussion. Three M's to me are the key: money, management, and markets. And anything that you can do from your legislative positions to increase the access of Latino and small businesses to these three M's, you're going to be doing a good job for the community. First M is money. And the senator has talked about it. Luis talked about it. We all know about it. How do we make sure that Latino businesses have access to the money, the capital that they need to develop, to expand, to grow, to connect to markets? So the first M is money and everything that you can do to facilitate the flow and access to money. Second is management, which is what Luis was talking about in terms of technical assistance. How can we make sure, when I was at the board of ACCION, we had cases of people showing up with duffel bags full of business receipts and things. And we had to spend a lot of person hours in terms of helping them turn that into an Excel spreadsheet, which would hopefully then turn into a more complicated accounting. And when the business was doing that, we knew that the business was going to grow and survive. If they'll come back next year with another bag of receipts, you knew that the time was up. So how do we make sure that, and Baruch College, we're at your service. It's the largest business school in the country. You fund it. You pay for it, the taxpayers of New York, through your good actions. Pay for it. There are tons of programs in entrepreneurship and small business development at the college and at the city university, your city university. Support them because they'll give the businesses the human capital and skills they need to be able to survive and grow. And third is access to markets. It's the markets. The local community markets, those businesses know very well. But those markets are very competitive, and those markets offer limited opportunities for growth. Now, they need you to be able to go from their very successful role in their neighborhood community slice of the market into broader markets in other communities, in other locations in the state, in other locations in the city. It may be in other industries if the entrepreneur is a particularly talented person. But in order for that to happen, I think there's some support that also needs to be provided in terms of marketing management and analysis and assistance to these small businesses. We all understand that the health and vitality of our community overall is going to depend, on the quality of jobs that our community is able to have access to, and that's really going to depend on the quality of the businesses that come from our community, that they're really intertwined. The health of workers is intertwined with the health of business owners and employers. When we forget that, I think we make policy in a way that doesn't benefit us all. When we remember that, I think we make policy in a way that benefits us all. So I hope that this information has been useful. I'm very easy to find on the internet, and I will encourage you to go to the Baruch College webpage. So go there. If you want to find me, go to the Baruch College webpage. There's a very easy directory to find, School of Public Affairs, or you can just do a search inside the website. But if I give you the email, it's easy. You won't go to the Baruch College website. So I'm in the Baruch College website. Go and play around with it. Look at the Center for Small Businesses. Look at the Entrepreneurship Center. Look at the courses that are offered in continuing education. Because those are all the assets and the skills that we all are going to need to develop in our community to be able to have healthy, vibrant small businesses. That, in addition to effective policymaker, I think is going to make the difference so that we can all benefit. Thanks again for your attention. I know it's a Saturday. Sometimes it's rough, but thanks again.
Luis, you did that pretty good under that time restraints. Thank you very, very much.
Sorry, I may have spoken a little faster than...
No, it was very informative, and we appreciated it. We've listened to Luis, and knowledge and access, education, access to government programs and dollars. We listened to Hector about money management, markets, also access to those, and to education as well. And now we're going to have Luis Vélez, who will speak to us. He is a... currently serves in Governor Andrew Cuomo's administration with the Empire State Development Corporation as a director of special projects. And prior to Mr. Velez's appointment, he serves as a senior advisor to Governor David A. Patterson. He's also held a number of executive positions in public service sector and was the founding partner of Caro Velez Caro and Mitchell LLP, which became New York City's largest Latino law firm. Mr. Velez practices law specializing in affordable housing, construction, litigation, and immigration. Mr. Velez serves as a trustee to the New York City Economic Development Corporation, is a member of the Latin Media and Entertainment Commission, LMEC, the commission that advises Mayor Michael Bloomberg on business development and retention strategies for the Latin media and entertainment industry. Mr. Velez received a BA at the Marist College and a JD from Georgetown University. Ladies and gentlemen, help me welcome Das Luis Velez.
Thank you very much. Fortunately, I know a good number of the people in the audience, but for the people that don't know me, the last 30 years of my life, I've devoted to small Latino business development in the state of New York. And I'm very proud of the many successes that many of my clients have had over that time period. And I'm very happy to be in public service now. Try and promote some programs and develop some opportunities for expansion of minority and women-owned businesses in state contracting. I'm going to take a minute of your time to tell you something personal that I think is important. On October 5th, I became a grandfather for the first time. And as I pondered the future of Francesca Velez, I thought to myself, you know, she's going to have some opportunities that prior Latinos hadn't had. She's a fourth generation Latino because my parents arrived in New York in the 1930s. And things have improved in areas of education, health, and other opportunities for Latinos. There's been great advances. In the area of economic development and business development, in my opinion, there have been very few. Although the 8A program has been around since it was initiated by President Nixon, in my opinion, I don't think there's a great deal of evidence that it's reached a large number of Latino businesses. And the businesses that succeed in that program succeed very well. They wind up getting multi-million dollar contracts, but the percentage of those businesses is minuscule. And the Small Business Administration has to do a lot more for minority and women-owned businesses than they're currently doing. So while there are some opportunities out there, you're going to find that things like not having collateral, any credit repairs that have to be done, will be huge obstacles for you to qualify for any of the loan programs that the SBA has. No business can really grow on loans alone. You cannot expand a business by borrowing money. You need investment capital. And the investment capital available to minority and women-owned businesses is nearly non-existent. So while there have been some successes in opening opportunities for Latino businesses over the past 40 years, there has not been enough. And all of you, if you haven't found out already, are going to have a great challenge to overcome in obtaining capital. And there are some resources out there, like the one that Lewis mentioned, the small business development centers throughout the state. There's 26 of them. The central one is in Albany, but there's one at Lehman College, LaGuardia College, and other sectors of the CUNY system, as well as the state university system. On the state side, the state has something like 29 entrepreneurial assistance programs, and they're located at places like SOGRO. You can go on the state's Economic Development Corporation's or Empire State Development Corporation's website and get more information. But you're really going to need a substantial amount of counseling to decipher the information that is out there. It's conflicting, sometimes it's inconsistent, and it can be very frustrating to try to figure this out on your own. And if you're a small business, you're unlikely to have 40 to 50 hours to figure this out on your own. So I would encourage you to utilize the resources that are out there. In the state of New York, MWBE, Minority and Women Business Enterprise Development, has been a concern of the state legislature and the governor since Mario Cuomo was elected governor. And there's been a number of statutes enacted to try to integrate the Latino and minority and women-owned communities into state procurement. The success of that has varied a great deal. And in some state agencies, you'll find that they had a 1% goal in the past and that they failed to achieve it. In other state agencies, you'll find that they had a 10% goal and they achieved a 20% goal. The extent to which agencies comply with goals depends on the CEO of each of those agencies. And the extent to which it's important to that CEO depends on a lot of factors. Of course, the most productive agency in the state has been DASNY, the Dormitory Authority. And as of late, their goals are something like 27% procurement for women and minority businesses. It's not surprising that the head of that agency is an African-American by the name of Paul Williams. Now, the answer is certainly not making the head of every agency a minority, although that's a goal we should strive for, but that's certainly not going to happen. But it is important to sensitize and find ways to sensitize and promote procurement in state contracting at each of those agencies. And there are a lot of elements that go into that. Part of that is being a unified Latino business or organizational group. If there isn't unity, then the likelihood of success is very slim, I would say. If there is unity, then you speak in a strong and singular voice about the needs that the Latino community has, and I think there's far more possibilities for success. Last year, I had the privilege of working on what's called the 2010 Business Diversification Act. The intent of that act was to try to develop a statewide uniform policy for implementation of MWBE goals in a more even way throughout the state. It therefore established the office of a chief diversity officer. Actually, it's not an office, it's an individual. The chief diversity officer reports directly to the governor, and that person's mission is to develop a uniform state policy and to provide direction and directives to state agencies on how to fulfill that policy. In addition to that, there were a lot of elements to the statute that promoted things like joint ventures, mentor-protege programs, teaming agreements to try to establish a variety of different ways to award contracts to minority and women-owned businesses. I'm at the Empire State Development Corporation at this point developing a mentor-protege program. The idea being is that unless the Latino community is integrated into the mainstream of economic development, its opportunity for choices are not going to be very great. The majority of the wealth in this state is controlled by white men. And unless you're at the tables where those kinds of businesses are being discussed, the likelihood of your inclusion is very small. So with the Mentor-Protege program, we're promoting opportunities for large corporations to sort of mentor small businesses throughout the state, not only minorities, but all small businesses, and develop that kind of relationship that introduces the proteges, the small businesses, into the mainstream of the state's economy, especially as it relates to state contracting. Now, I hope I haven't lost you all in what I said, but I've tried to be as broad and general about this as possible, and we'd be happy to answer any questions. Yeah.
Thank you, Des. I found this impressive. The knowledge that comes forward is good knowledge. But you know what I've noticed in the past? I used to bring, you know, scores of business people together. And I even, speaking of score, I had the SBA, their partner score, work out of my office. And I would see them help a small number of people. And I seen others that didn't want to take that step to reach out and get that help that they needed, because of the information they had to put down on the applications or because of the inability to deal with the application process. And in a lot of cases, I've seen it, that there just weren't a vehicle to inform them on how to get out and to access this. I've listened here to Luis and talk about access, and Hector as well on education, and yourself about opportunities. I think two of the things that I want to throw out there, and then we're going to open, it's a free-for-all, and we start asking questions. You know, are there enough opportunities for MBWs? And are those programs existing, for those Latino entrepreneurs? Are they here? Is there real opportunity? We've seen it on the board. We've seen Hector point it out. Are they being accessed? And other areas of concern, what is the emerging business opportunities for the Hispanic companies in today's environment? What are some of those potentials for those emerging business opportunities for the Hispanic communities in this environment? And ladies and gentlemen, there's a mic up here. We'll walk around, hand the mic to you. They're going to answer. Somebody jump on those two questions or three questions I threw out there, and then open up the floor.
So I'd like to comment on one thing before we open completely for discussion. As a small business owner with Balzac Capo Communications, and my wife and I were together in the business, she is the capo in the Balzac Capo. I will tell you that our biggest client for a while there was Western Union. And it was hard. If you want to play with the big boys, there's a lot you have to do. The bureaucratic process that we went through to be able to be part of Western Union's procurement was complicated. We're talking insurance, guarantees, bank accounts. We provided a lot of information. I understand what Das was saying about the SBA not being perfect and that we should have the SBA make certain changes. I will caution you about that. It is much easier for you to change what you can do than to expect the government to change for you. It's not easy. If you want to do business with the big guys, if you want to do business with the federal government, don't expect those institutions to change for you. If they do, take advantage of it. What you can do is change the way you do things. If you need to have better credit, start taking the steps to improve your credit. Start doing the homework. Take advantage of those tools that exist so you can play with the big guys. Don't sit and wait for those institutions to change, because things are tough. private financial institutions are making it tougher for everyone to borrow money. And many times it doesn't have anything to do with who is Latino. If your last name is Balzac, Smith, or Perez, they just want to make sure that you have collateral, and they want to make sure that they're not going to lose their money. It's hard. And if you want to do business, then you got to do your homework. And it's not easy. And I'm telling you, signing up Western Union as a client was extremely frustrating and expensive. The amount of money that I spent just in having the proper insurance was something that I took a hit. But when you do those things and they become your client, the money starts coming in. So I would caution you in expecting others to change, and instead change what you can control so that you can do better.
I think it's necessary that I make a comment here. In addition to being the director of special projects at the Empire State Development Corporation, I was also appointed by the White House to be an advisor to the Small Business Administration on underserved communities. In that role, Jorge Pura Silva and I put a number of roundtables together to talk to minority and women-owned businesses throughout the state. The overwhelming concern that they had are reflected in the comments that I've given you and are in a report I've already given to the SBA. Business and politics are inseparable. Economic development cannot happen with the support of the government. And in order to speak to the government, you have to speak in the most powerful way you can speak. And that's by having unified entities speaking on your behalf. I don't disagree with anything that Lewis said. You have to run your business the way businesses are supposed to be run. You should not expect the government to say, oh yeah, you got a lousy credit, well, we're gonna give you a loan anyway. I would oppose that. That makes no sense. But there are innovative ways of addressing the issues that are faced by large numbers of Latino firms. And a gentleman by the name of Muhammad Yunus of India was awarded the Nobel Prize in Economics in 2006 because instead of the normal due diligence around lending money that banks have devised over a number of years, he would lend money based on the support the borrower got from his neighbors who were engaged in the same activity as him. They currently opened a bank in New York whose clientele is overwhelmingly Latino. They have a 98% repayment rate, and their formula for lending is unlike anything the banking community in this country has ever seen before. So my point is, in addition to being the best fiscal manager of your business and obtaining the collateral and the things that you need to run a business, in addition to that, innovative ways have to be sought to reach our communities to provide them with the financing they need to perform on contracts and to grow their businesses.
Thank you very much, gentlemen. If you can, we're going to go to questions and answers, and we do have 10 minutes, so if you can be brief on the question and direct, and the same with the panel. I'd like to point out that the leader of the majority, State Senator Dean Skelos, has joined us, and the head of the finance, Robert Mojica. And I see Senator John Flanagan has also joined us. Thank you, John, for being here as well. Questions, please.
It's not on.
It's not on. It's a trick mic. Okay. Must have been a tough question coming up.
It is not a tough question. First of all, I want to say thank you for the support that you gave us when we went to Albany to fight for the delivery industry. You said that you're sponsoring this seminar here for small business. I think you have 30,000 or so more small businesses. I want you to keep on supporting that bill. I'm being involved in the merchant association in my area for the last almost 30 years. And like Louis say, one of the biggest problems that we had as a small business, either we run our businesses as small businesses, or we go and learn to have to fill out all those forms, like Lehman College, which I have been part of it, Bronx Community College as well. And on Tuesday, I'm going to have a meeting with lenders, small lenders, because our people, they don't need 50,000 as the gentleman, I apologize, talking about 2 millions, 5 millions. They need 10,000. They need 5,000. And they are responsible people to be in business for 20, sometimes 10 years. But the problem is that the bank, the Chase, and all those big institutions, although receiving a lot of money, they are not supporting our community. What can we do to say, listen, let's work together. You're taking the money from our community, you're receiving the money from our community, and after 27 years doing business with Chase, I had to leave then because they are not supporting my business. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. That's a very good question. I'm going to open it up to the panelists, and then I will finish up in a summation of what I believe we need to do. Gentlemen?
So I think that's where Das is completely correct. This is where you combine the being able to be independent and doing the right thing with a grassroots organized lobbying through the chambers, through advocacy groups, so that you provide the elected officials with the ammunition they need so they can carry your voice. I'm a lobbyist for Pfizer, and I've done advocacy for many years, and I have many friends that are elected officials. And when you meet with an elected official, you should always bring with you a show evidence of what the community thinks, feels, and what they need. So that when an elected official stands in front of the chambers, they can say, my constituents need the following. The chambers have written support letters. The businesses have written letters. We are united on this. And because of that, the elected official will find a way to support you. So that's when you combine advocacy to be able to communicate properly with the elected officials. I think that it's important that they understand what we need. And then the other part is that those private financial institutions that do business with us, there's a way to send them a signal also through these organizations to show them that they need us as much as we need them. It's a two-way street, I think.
A few quick reactions, and then I'll pass it to you. I think Das and Luis have earned an invitation to my next class to have a deeper conversation and debate about what we need to do in the community. I really appreciate the exchange because I think it's important. We don't learn if we only hear one perspective. I think we need to hear a range of perspectives, and I think they've complemented each other really well in the last question particularly. Every big business was once a small business. When you get depressed, you know, kind of think about that. Even the largest corporation you see today pretty much started as a small business, is that figure out how to make the right decisions along the fork and many forks on the road. So think strategically about those things. I think the question of microlending and microenterprise is the most fundamental question because it relates directly to the access to capital in the areas where we are and in the amounts that we need. Latino businesses are in the restaurant industry. Go try to find any bank that will give you any capital for any restaurant, no matter how good it is. I mean, it's just not the way that industry works. So obviously, different alternative forms of capital acquisition, having investor angels within the Latino community, and there's been some research on who are some of these kind of individuals with that money and how they can deploy more effectively to the Latino community directly through the vehicles that are the UNICEFs, the ACCIONs, the credit where credit is due, the various, you know, not individually, I'm not trying to individually talk about organizations, but how could we as an industry support the microlending industry, which is the only industry that has the capacity to give the amounts and do the due diligence in the way that our community needs so that the businesses can go from small to medium to then SBA-able and others. I think our conversation on asset building, or our conversation typically focuses on asset building, but you talked about, Senator, about what we can do in today's environment. I hope that the state at some point thinks about what we can do around asset preservation. We're losing a lot of businesses that with some refinancing or other
could really stay viable, but they're on a downward slope, and there's not an intervention that can help save them. So we're spending a lot of money trying to create new businesses. We're not doing enough to protect those that were viable at some point and are maybe on the ropes to stay viable and grow. And maybe it'd be cheaper.
Doctor, I agree with you, but we have a short period of time. Sorry. I just want to stay focused point? On the question that was asked, and I'll gladly, for another forum, that would be good. Yep. Can you add to that?
I just want to provide a little advice. There is a micro lenders association which is interested in making $10,000 loans, and there's perhaps 25 to 50 of those in the state of New York. There's also something called the FDICs, the Community Development Financial Institutions, which get a charter from the Department of the Treasury, and then they receive money from the federal government and the state of New York. We last year passed a bill that provided some $50 million to FDICs for this level and this type of funding. Large banks can't afford to make a $10,000 loan. It's not that they're bad people. It's just that what they pay their employees and what their overhead is so high, they're just not in a position to do that kind of thing. So you might want to look on the internet for FDICs and microlenders.
Thank you very much. The line of credits that you speak of, a business or home, and most of us, a lot of you use both home and business lines of credit to be able to function in business today. What I would do, whether it be a community or it would be an industry, I would have a banking forum. I would bring in the banks from that community or from that industry. I would line them up, and I'd ask them very simply, how can you help our community? And could you list the number of loans that you've given out in our community for X, Y, and Z? And they'll have to be able to tell you that, and they'd have to be able to have somebody of a serious nature from that bank to be able to answer those questions. So you'd have a senior vice president at that meeting. And I do believe that you would find that you'd open up processes where there would be additional loans made to either that community or to that industry. That's one of the ways that I would approach it. Question?
Yes, thank you. You're not Leo Sosa, Executive Director, Share New York. My question is reference to Mr. Daz Vélez mentioned with Latino business and getting more involved, maybe getting up to par with today's economical world, business world. A few years ago, under my previous employer, we worked very hard with the City Field and its construction contracts. We worked with the new City Economic Development, we worked with the Borough President, and we created seminars, we did MWB certification. I mean, we did just about everything we could. And there was even about 20-25% of the contracts allocated to small businesses in Queens. However, the end result was that, I mean, there wasn't much participation. Many people did not certify, and those that were certified didn't really participate. And we're talking about small contracts. We made it easy, maybe $200,000 for putting up a large TV screen, 100 of them, or maybe putting tiles in the bathroom for $500,000. I mean, it was very accessible. What is the best advice you can give to small businesses in reference to reaching out to, you know, and certifying? It seems as if there's something missing. I don't know if it's within the, for example, the Latino world where the language is lacking, or maybe I do know, and let's be realistic, some of these small businesses just to get by, they rely on immigrant labor. I don't know. But what's your best advice to these, you know, to people here who are small businesses and trying to get some of these contracts, but somehow they're missing that link?
That's a real good question, and it doesn't have a great answer yet, except for the fact that our current governor and this current administration are really committed to MWB participation and projecting a 20% statewide goal, which is a great policy. The resources for certifying firms are very limited. So while there are apparently something like 500,000 women and minority-owned firms in the state of New York, we've only certified 6,500. The process is involved because there's a huge concern that these type of companies not be used as fronts. If you read the paper over the past year, you'll know that some major construction companies were fined $20 million because they were using fronts to reach their goal participation. So it's a difficult process, and we're living in a very frugal period of time in terms of resources. But they need to apply, and they need to push, and they need to lobby for themselves and see if that can help. But from the standpoint of the government, we're looking at ways of alleviating the process. The federal government, for example, in many of their procurements, allow women-owned businesses to self-certify. If you're a woman-owned business and you sign an affidavit saying, I'm certified and I own this business, I control the business, and I do all these things, that's all the federal government asks for your participation as in woman-owned businesses. Now, the same courtesy is not extended to minority-owned businesses. This is something recent that was initiated last March and part of President Obama's agenda. I'd like to see similar things done in the state of New York, but that's going to take time, and that's going to take politics, and that's going to take support from organizations and people like you.
Are the numbers half a million minority businesses and only
and women-owned?
And women-owned, and less than 10,000 are qualified, are registered?
Are registered, not that they're not qualified, that are registered. There's, for a contract with the state of New York, you have to be certified by the state of New York. But there are other certifying bodies. The there's a women's organization. It's MWPEO, Women Presidents Entrepreneurs Organization. They do their own certification, and that certification is valuable in private sector businesses. Somebody's shaking their head, and you can have an opportunity to correct that. There's also the New York, New Jersey Minority Purchasing Council. They do certification. There's other places you can be certified, but for a state contract, you have to be certified by New York State.
How many are certified with the state?
Right now with the state, it's 6,500.
So that's less than 0.5%.
Oh, so it's a tiny amount, but on the other hand, we're only talking about people that would be interested in state contracts. A lot of small businesses would not be interested in bidding on state contracts.
But before we go to that, but your question really is, those contracts that you were talking about, were state or city contracts?
City contracts. The end result was that a very small percentage of them,
The end result was that a very small percentage, when there was 25% of the business allocated for MWBs and small businesses, minority businesses, and only a very small percentage actually ended up in the hands of minority businesses.
Yeah, but how could they end up in minority businesses when we have half a million?
That's my question. I mean, is it the way the business, small businesses are structured? Is the certification too difficult? Because I know that they have to go through certain products, and they can only make so much money a year. You see, and there's other issues. Like, for example, again, we have immigrant workers. They work in these small businesses. So is there a way that maybe we can facilitate the process without making it too easy? We don't want to make it too easy, but is there a way of maybe making it more accessible so that, for example, when we have these construction, you can have a higher number of NWEs and small businesses involved?
Could you hand that mic over to that young lady there, please, and then we got to wrap it up.
Just some comment. I'm Marisa Polanco for Polanco Creative Survey. I'm been certified since 1997 as a small business. I come into the country as an immigrant in 1995, create my company in 1996, certified in 1997. You need to know the system. You need to educate yourself. But after you certify, you need to do the homework, as he said. You need to have in the vendor list, you need to go to the workshop, seminar, conference, go Washington, go Albany, you know what you write. But there is a unified certification that you can unify. It's a lot of things there, but the thing is, mostly the funding, everybody want to create their own certification. I think there is two things. We have federal, we have a city, I'm sorry, three things. Federal, city, and state. Now, the issue is time consuming. I'm decertified since 1997. Every year, last year in 2010, I'm submitting I do between 5 to 10 bids every day with the city and the state. But what happened it's based in price. How can me, a small business, can bid with a white company that have money, that pay somebody behind? There's too many things that happen there, you know? But nobody wants to talk. Nobody wants to talk really what is the issue there. And then is one thing. money issue. Last year, 90% of the Polanco income was certified by federal contract. Was getting the 90% of my income in the company was city contract and a state contract. That means you need to do your homework, you need to know your right, you need to educate yourself. There's too many issues over there. And also money.
Thank you very much. Okay, Luis, did you want to have something to say?
Yeah, I'll say something. I don't even know where to start. The whole thing about white and all that stuff,
You are closing statements, so close nicely.
Yeah. I am not going to accept that the whole racism thing. I know that exists, yes. I'm not saying we should ignore it. What I am trying to say is that I think, and I think you agreed with me, is that it's tough to be certified. But people don't do it. The problem is, you just said that it's time-consuming to keep up with it and to do all the things you need to do, and that requires time. If you want to make the business with the city, state, or federal government, then do your homework and try to qualify and do the business. There are mandates that require these institutions to do business with Latinos. So what you said, that a white business will grab your contract, does not apply, because a white business cannot apply as a minority-owned Latina business. Those are two different pots of money.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have to wrap it up. If you can, Luis, please. And
I'll just say thank you to the panelists.
Thank you.
I think it shows today's Saturday. Some of us could be at home resting, and instead we're here because we care. And I congratulate everyone for attending.
Give Mr. Lopez a round of applause. He's in the back. He's one of the gentlemen that put this together. Give the staff here a round of applause for their great work. And please give this great panel here, Mr. Luis Balzac, Dr. Hector F. Cordero Guzmán, and Luis Vélez. Give them a round of applause, please. Thank you. I want to thank my leader, Dean Skelos, the majority leader, for putting this together today. And working with the minority community and making sure here the Latino community is forward and front and forward with projects, with the ability to do business, with the ability to access funding, with the ability to get a workforce, with the ability to have the education, the knowledge, and the way for all to stay on the front lines, to create new business, and to march into the future 21st century. Thank you, and God bless you.